Kia ora, I'm Kia.
And I'm Mackenzie.
And this is StudyTime's Level 1 Science video for genetics. Genetics is another meaty Level 1 Science standard with lots of definitions to learn and lots of concepts to memorize.
But luckily, like a lot of other bio standards, we can break it down into three rough sections. The first of which being DNA and how exactly it works, inheritance and variation, and thirdly, reproduction, survival, and good old evolution.
If you want to really get into the content, check out our walkthrough guides, but follow this video for strategies for success to come out on top for these exams.
For bio and NCEA, it's critical that you know your definitions very strongly and that you're comfortable with using them in a range of situations so you can use the context in your answers. So some of the key definitions for this standard is gene, allele, chromosome, mutation, genotype, phenotype, gamete, zygote, dominant, recessive, homozygous, heterozygous, pure breeding, Punnett squares, and pedigree charts. Alongside all these definitions is a really common question asking to explain the difference between DNA, genes, alleles, chromosomes, and resulting genotypes and phenotypes. So, what is DNA? It's a molecule that holds all of our genetic information like a blueprint. It stays in the nucleus of the cell until it undergoes mitosis or meiosis. Now, what DNA has is links of base sequences that code for amino acids and proteins that carry out functions in our body. Now, a length of DNA is called a gene, and an allele is an alternate version of a gene. So say, for example, the gene is eye color, an allele of it might be blue eyes versus brown eyes. Now, that's a relationship between genes and alleles. Now, these result in genotypes and phenotypes. So what your genotype is it's the pair of chromosomes that you have for a gene, and these can be dominant or recessive. And what the phenotype is the physical expression of this gene. So if you're having trouble remembering it, remember that phenotype, physical expression. You got that PH, PH there. So link those together in your mind.
This standard is all about variation, which is the differences that individuals can have in their genetic makeup. One of the main ways of gaining variation is through mutation, which is a change in a DNA base sequence, meaning that a different protein is made and a different phenotype is produced. This is important because it results in a production of a new allele. Another way of gaining variation is through meiosis. Remember, meiosis creates gametes, or sex cells, whereas mitosis is the production of non-sex cells, or somatic cells. Now, each individual has 23 pairs of chromosomes, meaning two copies of a gene, and therefore two alleles. For example, you can have big W and small W, where big W is one allele and small W is another. Each gamete made in meiosis has only one set of our 23 chromosomes, so only one copy of the gene. One set is from our mum and one from our dad. Chromosomes shuffled randomly increases variation during meiosis, and this random assortment ensures that a different gamete is produced each time. Another source of variation is through fertilization. Sex reproduction combines DNA from two parents using gametes. A gamete has one set of chromosomes, and you can combine this with another parent's set of chromosomes to make a unique individual. So random male and female chromosomes will combine to make a unique zygote, or fertilized egg. So this random reproduction increases variation through individuals.
As you'll be painfully aware of by now, this standard also requires that you interpret and sometimes draw Punnett squares or pedigree charts. Now, what Punnett squares are is it shows you the expected genotypic outcome of a pairing of two organisms. Now, within this, for merit and excellence, what you really want to be doing is discussing how it's all a game of probability, and that there will sometimes be a difference between your expected phenotype outcome and what actually happens, the practical outcome. And this is because every pairing, every fertilization is completely by chance. And what this means is that every time fertilization occurs, you have a 1 of 4 chance of getting any of those genotypic outcomes. Now, pedigree charts can be kind of thought of as a genetic family tree, where you're shown all the phenotypes of individuals within a family. And for merit and excellence in this section, what you really want to be doing is predicting the genotypes based off the phenotypes. And here's a way that you can do it. If you have a parent, two parents that both show the dominant gene, however they produce an individual that is homozygous recessive and showing the recessive gene, what this means is that both parents have to be heterozygous to both produce a recessive gene that fertilizes together. Using things like this, you can predict the genotype of sometimes entire pedigree charts, and this is really, really useful in understanding exactly what is going on.
Another question that is commonly asked is the difference between inheritable and non-inheritable variation. Or in basic terms, when is a change in phenotype passed down to an offspring? Inheritable variation can be passed down to an offspring and involves a change or mutation in the DNA. Whereas non-inheritable variation might be due to an environment or only occurring in non-sick cells and only affects that organism and won't be passed down onto an offspring. For example, if you get a scar on your arm. Based on that, a phenotype is therefore determined by both genetics and the environment. Just because an individual has a gene or allele that codes for a specific trait doesn't necessarily mean that their phenotype will express it, as the environment may change around that individual.
Our final tip comes in the form of the differences between asexual and sexual reproduction, where asexual reproduction is fast and effective, but it doesn't have a lot of opportunity to introduce genetic variation. Asexual reproduction is time effective and can be costly, but it does introduce more variation, which is obviously very beneficial. Now, these benefits can come in the form of resistance to new selection pressures. So if a new selection pressure is introduced, whether this be due to a natural disaster or a new predator, what it means is if the gene pool is more varied, it's more likely that within this gene pool, there is an allele which is resistant to this new selection pressure. It's important to bear in mind that you're not discussing new mutations forming in response to new selection pressures and that it is all 100% by chance. Now, asexual reproduction, because of this reduction in genetic variation, is obviously far less resistant to new selection pressures. So this has been StudyTime's Level 1 strategy video for genetics. One final tip from us, if you're struggling to know where to get started, highly recommend learning your definitions. These are important to every question that you're going to have to answer, so it's a really good way to get a good idea of the standard as a whole.
And if you want to get more into the content of the standard, check out our StudyTime walkthrough guides, available for free online or if you want to buy them in print with next day delivery. And check out past exams, practice writing out those answers.
Cool, that's been it from us guys. Good luck and thanks for watching.